Hey, Stargazers. Welcome back. My name is Nick. I'm a theaters manager at the Adler Planetarium, and you're watching Skywatch Weekly. Well, this week we have a beautiful snowy full moon coming up, as well as some beautiful planets to look for. We're going to start with, of course, the planet everyone's been talking about recently, Mars, the red planet. Let's begin looking southwest about an hour after sunset tonight. You'll find the beautiful planet Mars here, the site of the successful landing of the Perseverance rover last week. Since then, we've received amazing views from the rover, including images just minutes after touchdown. And we've even seen incredible imagery from the rover's descent onto the surface. This mission promises to provide us with amazing views of the red planet up close for a long time to come. Well, here on Earth, we may not get those close-up views from our backyard, but this week you can watch a beautiful pairing of the red planet and a cluster of stars that we've talked about before, the Pleiades. The Pleiades star cluster is part of the zodiac constellation Taurus the Bull. An easy way to find it, in addition to being near the bright planet Mars right now, is to point with the belt of Orion the Hunter up through the V-shape of stars marking the face of Taurus and onto the Pleiades. This cluster is also known as the Seven Sisters. The Pleiades contains over 1,000 stars, but with the naked eye, there are usually 6 or 7 to be seen, and occasionally more with a very dark sky and sharp eyesight. Binoculars give a terrific view, and a telescope can begin to pick up some of the nebulosity here, dust and gas through which these stars are passing. The dust and gas is illuminated by the light of these young stars, giving the whole scene a bluish, wintry tinge. Well, over the next couple of weeks, you can see some planetary motion in action as the red planet glides by this beautiful cluster as seen from Earth. They're both in a binocular field of view, but even to the naked eye, it's a beautiful close pairing, with the color contrast between the hot blue stars and the ruddy soil of Mars, making it a particularly eye-catching event. Mars starts tonight a little bit below the cluster, but watch each night as it makes its way a little bit farther east, passing closest next week, but within a binocular's field of view for much longer. These two haven't been so closely paired in the sky since 2006, and it'll be another 17 years until they're this close again. Since the Pleiades star cluster lies so close to the ecliptic, the plane of the solar system, it often has fairly close pairings with planets and also the moon. You might remember last April, the planet Venus passed essentially through this cluster, as seen from Earth. So give it a look, and over the next couple of weeks, notice how the position of Mars changes relative to the Pleiades from one night to the next. Well, the moon will also be putting on a show this week, with a full moon rising at sunset on Friday night. Your calendar might show Saturday as the date of the full moon, and technically the moon is at its fullest in the early morning hours of Saturday, but it will appear fuller from North America on Friday evening than it will Saturday evening. February's full moon is traditionally called the snow moon, and for much of the country right now, that'll seem a pretty fitting name. Full moons at this time of the year reach a very high altitude in the sky from the northern hemisphere, so the moonlight illuminating a snow-covered landscape seems all that much brighter. Friday's full moon will make it up to about 2/3 of the way up in the sky here in Chicago. Now compare that to the full moon in June, which barely makes it 1/4 of the way up above the horizon. It's the opposite of the sun, which appears low in the sky this time of the year and high in the sky in the summer. Since the full moon is always opposite the sun in the sky, it will essentially do the opposite of what the sun is doing at that time of the year. The full moon presents a very different view than the first quarter that we looked at last week. Of course, the shape is different, but the way its surface looks changes too. The first quarter moon and the days surrounding it are a prime time to look at the topography of the moon. The cratering and the texture of the moon is apparent, especially through binoculars or a telescope. The full moon, though, looks very flat, with little shadowing visible. It's really difficult to get a sense of depth during this phase, but it is a particularly good time for seeing the contrast between different areas. The classic pictures that we've seen in the face of the moon during its full phase, like the man in the moon, the woman in the moon, the rabbit, among others, those are formed by the darker patches on the face of the moon. These are called maria, or seas, and they were formed long ago as molten material filled in lower-lying areas on the moon. These lie in contrast to the highlands, the brighter areas that are much older. Brighter still are some of the rays that spray out from the more recent impact craters. Best known is Tycho Crater, near the bottom of the moon, as seen from mid-northern latitudes. The impact that formed this crater is estimated to have occurred about 100 million years ago, when dinosaurs walked the Earth. Some of the material that was ejected during this collision splashed across the face of the moon, and the bright lines or rays can be easily noticed during the full phase, especially with binoculars or a telescope. The crater Proclus, which lies near the small circular Mare Crisius, has a ray system that is asymmetrical, indicating that the colliding object came in at a very shallow angle, so very little material sprayed in the direction that it came from. While the moon is the brightest object in the nighttime sky, it's visible from any type of sky, even during the day, and its appearance changes from night to night, so there's always something new to discover as you look at it. So next time you've got a clear sky and the moon is up, make sure you get out there and take a look. Well, if you're up for a bit of an early morning excursion, there's a trio of planets visible tomorrow morning, February 25th, about 30 minutes before sunrise. To the east-southeast, Jupiter, Mercury, and Saturn will be visible rising just before the sun. These three will be visible for the next few mornings as well, but tomorrow they'll form a nice little triangle, and Mercury will be at its easiest viewing for this orbit. Jupiter will be the brightest of the three, followed by Mercury, and then Saturn. Jupiter and Saturn you may not have seen or even thought about since their historic conjunction back in December. So catch them now. They're on their first steps of a journey that'll take them out of the dawn glow and eventually to dominating the nighttime skies this summer. So if you happen to be up and have a clear morning, definitely give them a look. Well, that's what we have for you this week. Thanks, as always, for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to Adler's YouTube channel and follow us on social media. Happy moon watching, and we'll see you next week.